the morning prayer on this third Sunday after Epiphany, and this morning we're coming from St. Peter's Church, Laois. And if you would like to join us, please open the prayer books on page 101 or page 37 for the large print edition. Let us pray. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins, receive God's forgiveness, to hear His holy word proclaimed, to bring before Him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray that in the power of His Spirit we may serve Him and know the greatness of His love. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father, and we recall perhaps some of the wrong we've done in the past week, and also some of the good we have failed to do. As we pray, Heavenly Father, we have sinned against You and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve You in newness of life, to the glory of Your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth will proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. And we have our first reading this morning from the book of Jonah.
The first reading, Jonah, chapter 3, beginning at the first verse. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on a sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Here ends the reading.
We now have our first hymn this morning.
Grace. A reading from the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 14. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of the Lord.
In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Just a few thoughts this morning on those two readings from Mark and Jonah. They both have a fishy theme about them. Many of us have heard the story of Jonah from a very early age, and we undoubtedly associate Jonah with the whale. And our Gospel reading includes stories of fishermen who are called to become fishers of men. But back to Jonah. Jonah is a typical reluctant prophet. Early in the story, God calls him to go at once to Nineveh and deliver a message to the people there. Repent, stop your wickedness, and God will forgive you. But there is something that Jonah doesn't want to do. He tries his best to escape, sailing to the ends of the earth, heading in the opposite direction to where God wants him to be. And he's thrown overboard, the ship in a storm, and then we have the story of the whale that swallows him and brings him right back to the same country, the very same country he was trying to escape from, and spits him up on the beach. Because you have to remember that God will get you to be where you are meant to be, no matter what you do. God is not going to let Jonah off that easily, and gives him a second opportunity to obey. And he does eventually go to Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, which is one of the biggest cities in that region at that time. It is said it would have taken a person about 3 days to walk from one side of the city to the other. But it seems Jonah is easily distracted and happy with half measures. And after only a day and barely reaching halfway to the city, he stops. Now, in some ways, I can understand Jonah's reluctance. His reluctance to go and preach this message of forgiveness and give these people a second chance. And the reason is that the people of Nineveh were a traditional enemy of the people of Israel. They were not part of the chosen. In the mind of the Israelites, these people were foreigners and they were sinners. And I suppose in the mind of Jonah, he wanted God to bring down fire and destruction upon the city and wipe them off the face of the earth. I'm sure he could not understand why God would want to save the enemies of Israel. It just did not make sense to go and tell the people that God, Jonah's God, was concerned about them as well. He could not allow himself to accept that God wanted to forgive someone who did not belong, and that God wanted them to have a second chance. Jonah, well, he couldn't stomach this, for he wanted God's mercy to be reserved for Israel only, the chosen people. And Jonah could not understand what God had in mind. But even then, in all of Jonah's confusion, God gives this Jewish prophet in this foreign land a second chance. God does something a second time. He speaks to Jonah, even after all he's done. After Jonah learns the hard way that there is no point in running away from God simply because his plans are not God's plans. So he reluctantly goes and preaches. The people of Nineveh hear what Jonah has to say, and they react positively. But This is to Jonah's dismay. They take his words to heart. Even the king puts on sackcloth and ashes and prays for God's redemption. They turn from their evil ways, and God changes his mind and the disaster that they were about to face. And then Jonah heads off once again, running away from God in a sulk. Things did not go as he had wished or hoped for. How could God be merciful to these people? How could God give them a second chance? Now, if you look at this today, we can see that perhaps it's a very entertaining story, but a good ending. Funny, is it not, that God gave Jonah a second chance, but Jonah in his anger could not understand why God gave the people of Nineveh a second chance. And he could not rejoice in that. And maybe there is something that we should think about today. For God is asking us some serious questions through this prophet. A prophet who wanted his enemies to suffer. One question God is asking in this is, what do you want for your enemies? The people who have hurt us, the people we don't like, perhaps even the people we hate. What do you want God to do for them? Or maybe, what do you want God to do to them? As you watch the news and you see about our political enemies, perhaps at home or abroad, what do you want God to do for them or to them? It's a difficult question to answer. Jonah wanted God to send fire and destruction upon his enemies. But God's compassion caught Jonah by surprise, because God was telling him, I do not want to destroy your enemies. I want to save them. I do not want to hurt those who have hurt you. I want to help them and change their lives. And I want you, Jonah, to help me to do that. I want you, Jonah, to bring about healing, the healing of your enemy. I want you, Jonah, to bring a message of love and break down the walls that divide. And I want you to love them enough, Jonah, to preach this message of love to them. For you are my child, and they also are my children. So it's no wonder Jonah fled. Do we too want to flee? And then in today's Gospel from Mark, Jesus proclaims the core of his message. The kingdom of God is at hand. Today, repent and believe in the good news. Today, repent is what God wanted for the people of Nineveh. And it is what he wants the followers of Jesus to do as well. It's what God wants all of his children to do. Repent, which means a change of heart. To stop going the wrong way and come home to Jesus. Simon, Andrew, James and John are so fascinated by Jesus' invitation. They leave behind their fishing nets. They leave behind what entangles them. And they follow Jesus. If, like them, we want to follow Christ and embrace the repentance he calls us to, we need to be ready for some special changes in our lives, some real changes. But what would you do today if Christ said, I want you to go to your enemies, and I want you to love them? What would you do if Christ asked you to go to your adversaries and help to heal them? Bring them the good news of forgiveness. Bring them the good news of Christ. To bless the very people we struggle to love, perhaps even those who hate us. Would we go there? Or would we want to flee, just like Jonah? And like Nineveh, we have so much repenting to do. For we sit by as the homeless and the poor struggle to find something to eat. We sit by as the immigrant and the refugee are imprisoned in our direct provision centres. We've so many wrongs to make right. There's so many injustices to call out. But perhaps we're slow to act. We are called to be a blessing to a bruised world, to be a prophet to a broken world. So don't, like Jonah, hide in the belly of a fish. The good news is for all, and we are all called to share. Amen. We open our prayer books on page 112, and we reaffirm our faith to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. O Lord, guide and defend our rulers, and grant our government wisdom. Let your ministers be clothed with righteousness, and let your servants shout for joy. O Lord, save your people, and bless those whom you have chosen. Give peace to our time, O Lord, and let your glory be over all of the earth. O God, make clean our hearts within us, and renew us by your Holy Spirit. And our college for this third Sunday after Epiphany. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness sustain us by your mighty power, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we now have our second.
Let me hide myself in thee. Let the Lord.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we bring before you our prayers and thanksgivings this morning, as we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ, remembering all those Christians in our world who are persecuted because of their faith. We ask that you give them hope and certainty to remain steadfast in your love and care. We pray for this alone parish, and we ask that you bless my bishop. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask that you make us aware that you are ever calling us to new ventures, new visions, calling us to step out in faith and follow. We pray for those communities in which we belong. We pray for our neighbours as we pray for ourselves. And at this time of uncertainty and worry, we pray for teachers and students, for all those working on our front lines during this pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, give you thanks for this wonderful world that you have made, and that we live in and call our home, a place of beauty and amazement. But help us to be mindful that we are but caretakers. Caretakers of all that you have created. Teach us how to live in harmony with all of your creation. This morning we pray for our own country, for the leaders of this, our own land, our president, our teacher, and all in authority. But let us remember those who are forgotten by society, the homeless, the refugees. We pray for all who have talked about, all who have struggled, and have achieved perhaps little. For those whose world has collapsed around them. For those who are frustrated with life and feel like giving up. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray this morning for all those who are sick, whether in hospitals, or nursing homes, or at home. And we especially pray for Elsie, for Linda, for Billy, for Vera, for Evelyn, and all those known to us who are sick. We also pray for those who care for them, doctors, nurses, and hospital staff, family members and spouses. But we also pray for our loved ones, for those members of our families that we have not seen perhaps in many weeks or months. And we ask that you keep them safe and well until we meet again. Lord, in your mercy. And as we end our prayers, we say together, Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And our final blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you, now and forever.